Hey everyone, and welcome to World Class, conversations with the industry's top photographers, cinematographers, and visual artists. Today we speak with French DOP Romain Wilhelm, a very talented commercial and narrative cinematographer. He speaks to us today about his work and about how to get world-class images from small crews and under tight timelines. He speaks to us today from his home in Paris. Romain, thank you for joining us for the World Class series. I'm really excited to have you. I've been a fan of your work for a while. What I want to do is to start off with you telling us a little bit about your career, and I think it's going to be really unique for our audience because you are in Europe, and our audience may be here in North America, may not be as familiar with maybe the processes in career development in your trade that happens in Europe. But tell us a little bit about how you started on your career and then how you got to where you are today as a director of photography.
I started my career in a small company, is Astrolab. It's a small production, and I was a student who went to the school and 2 days on work. You know, I don't know, it's alternance in French. And I made I work on a lot of set. And I was assistant, and I started by sound, you know. And after I went with a family in French, it's like a family crew with in feature. And I started by second AC, first AC, and sometimes I did first AC too. And I work on a more big project, and I did 3 years in Astrolab, and after that I went on the marketplace, you know, and I tried to work with other people, and I met another GOP, and I was his AC, and now I learn a lot with this guy and other guy, and I try to do my image. I try to do my way of director, you know.
And were you interested in cinematography or in film or in cinema as a youth, as a child, or was it something that evolved after school?
Yes, my uncle is a photographer. It was a photographer, and he gave me a camera when I have 11, 12, and I took a lot of pictures and with Polaroid, you know. Mm-hmm. And I started like this, and when I was 18, I decided to do this work, you know, for me.
And so did you, when you started with the production company, did you go to film school first? Did you go to school to take film?
Yes, it's in French, I don't know in English, it's in French, it's alternance. You went 2 days on school, 3 days on the production company per week for 1 or 2 hours, for 2 years. And I stopped by one year because for me, this job learn on the set and not on the school, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's also happening a lot here in North America, where people will start in film school and realize halfway through that they're already getting lots of work, and they decide not to continue with film school because they'd rather just take the work. You know, did you find for you when you went from being a first AC to being a director of photography, did you have to go as we say in English, all out? Did you have to quit completely being a first AC, or were you able to slowly take work as a director of photography?
No, at this time I split enough. I was AC last 2 months ago on the feature, on a big feature, because I think for the moment I need to learn more and more with a big crew and big set for grow up on this industry, you know. And in France, you can split. You can do the first AC and sometimes director of photography. And I think the main difference is that in France you have a tradition, and so you starting by third AC, second AC, first AC, and if you are a good first AC, nobody wants to do director of photography because it's difficult to find a good focus puller or a good AC, a guy who do the best work. And it was right with the film, you know, and now with the numeric, I think the mentalities, you know, change, you know, and it permit that the guy like me shoot the project and make commercials or film with a less budget, mm-hmm. and you can become a good director of photography, mm-hmm. and you know, first AC too.
Yeah. And did you was your whole career here in France, or is that where you grew up and started your career, or were you in any other countries?
No, I work two times, and I shot two features in USA and two commercials in USA, and I shot on Africa and Dakar in Senegal and Romania, in Bucharest, you know. And I work where the work is.
Yeah. So let's go into talking about two of your big projects that I want to focus on today. The first being a commercial, which is how I discovered you, which is a commercial for Goyard, which is a trunk maker in Paris. They make sort of luggage and trunks. And it's a piece called Le Rendezvous. And it won a Vimeo Staff Pick, which is how I think I discovered it. It's really, really incredible. I found it was really incredible for a number of reasons. One is the stylistic nature of it. You had told me that it was shot on a C300, on an original C300, which blew my mind because it looks like Arri Alexa footage. And to see that comes from a 8-bit 422 camera is credit to your abilities and your ability to create a very great image. Can you tell us a little bit about that project, how you became a part of that project, and how you planned for it and shot it as well?
Yeah, for the first things, it's a whole team, you know. I'm not just me. The director are amazing. It's two directors, Sam and Raf, and the production company are very, very cool, and stylist for the girls, and the makeup artist. Everything on this commercial are right, you know. And to be really honest, it was my first project on DP. And I have a little bit pressure, you know.
Wow, you really knocked it out of the park for our first project. You really did an amazing job.
It's we shot it with the C300 and EF lenses, you know, just Canon lenses. And it was the first time where Goya, the brand, communicate, you know. So he let the, for the ID on the director, it's really free.
Yeah. There's no restrictions on the creative.
Yeah, no restriction. And we shot it with two C300. We are a small crew too. I was alone with an assistant. With an assistant, you know, some. It's not a gaffer. It's more like a best boy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we have just a small few things, three or four LEDs, kino flows, flag, you know, mama. And the apartment, the place, it's very cool. And at this moment, the light, it's really, I don't know, sometimes you are a bit lucky. And when you shoot it, the light, it's perfect. You know, I can't explain that. Sometimes we need the chance for the bigger.
And so, obviously, when you go into a project like this, normally for any director of photography, you're going to do a scout of the location. You're going to go and look and know where the sun is going to fall at what time of day. So how much of what we see in the final product was as a result of pre-production and planning and knowing where everything was going to be, and how much of that was just luck?
It's just 2 days of shoot, you know?
Wow.
So the prep, it's really straight. Just 1 day. And we scout 2 days before the shoot, you know? And just it's displaced. I don't know if I can say that, but some projects in France are with a little budget, you know? We have not time to prep like a US guy or I don't know in Canada, but the prep is important for me. I think it's the best part of the work. You know, if you have a good prep, you have 17% of the work is done, you know. And in France, sometimes the problem is that we haven't time for that, or nobody, all the people who work on this project are not free at the same time, and you can do scouting. It's crazy. So it's just 2 days before, and we did a list, and let's go, you know.
And how did it come to be that you get a project like this for your first project? It's such an outstanding piece of work that. How did you connect with the directors? How did you know the directors? How did they ask you to be part of this project?
Yeah, I connect with the director by the production company. It's the production company where I starting my career. It's Astrolab. It's like when I got out the company, I don't know, 6 months later, the project come. And he called me, Romain, do you want to do this project? I say yes. And I meet the director, and we discussed about the light and how I can feel the project. And it's much directly, you know. Sometimes when you meet somebody, you know, at the first time, it's if it's okay or not.
Yeah.
And this, it's alchemy.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's alchemy, and we work, and we did. I think we did an amazing work, and I was the first person who was surprised to do the staff picks. When you are behind the camera. You can't imagine you have a staff pick at the end. But it was a good project, and the color it's very cool. Everything it's good. So at the end the big picture it's cool. It's perfect.
And there's some really fascinating things that. I find are happening with the external scenes, the skyline scenes,
yeah.
That look like there's some sort of filtration in front of the lens. some really cool, what appears to be in-camera effects there. Can you talk a little bit about what those were and how you achieved that that image?
Yeah, it's a secret, you know. I can't tell you how exactly we did that because it's just a clear.
Yep.
Like a clear, and you put some I don't know in English glycerin.
Yep.
I
yep. Glycerin. Yep.
Vaseline. Or,
yep.
You know, and you put on the clear, and you put this on the front, and you try to put the good the good light on the good moment, and you know it's. The shot of Paris shotted after the main set because the sky is not how the director wants, you know. You want the cloudy
Did you find that this changed your career after this, after you get to do this work and then get the staff pick? Was there more interest in other production companies using, in other directors using you as a director of photography?
Yeah, it's like, it's after this shot, I meet another director for a feature, for an independent feature. And I think it's a visit card. This movie, this commercial, it's a visit card because some the people say ask to me, oh, you shoot the Goya, and it was amazing, and it's very cool. And you know, it's like you contact me because you see Goya. Wow. It changed, after the shoot, Goya, it's like an accreditation, you know, and the place, you know. I can show the good image. I can do the good image, you know.
And that's, I mean, the really great thing too is when we look at your body of work on your website, we do see, like any really good director of photography, that there is a wide variety of work. Not all of your work looks identical, and that you have a lot of resourcefulness as a DP. And which leads us into the features that you've been working on, and the two that brought you to the United States. This is your second feature, NY84, that you did with Cyril Morin. And for those who don't know who Cyril is, he is a very accomplished composer who did the music for Samsara, which is a very, very famous movie. And so he's got well over 100 musical scores and films that he's scored. And then he also has directed and done a few other roles. How did you meet him, and how was it like, what was it like working with such a unique director that comes from a musical background?
Yeah, I met Cyril because I have a friend of me goes to USA for work, and she meets Cyril, and he asks, do you know a good DP? And because I have a feature when I want to shot last year, next year, blah 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 blah. And she gave him my phone, you know. And we meeting on the Starbucks, and yeah, I show him Goya, I show him music videos.
And with NY84, tell us a little bit about this film, what it's about, and then you can talk to us about all the things that went into. I understand there were some interesting things, some interesting problems that you had to contend with But first, tell us about the film, and then you can talk to us about the production.
Yeah. So NY84, it's a docu-fiction. It's a hybrid, the action in New York in the 80s. It's a story of AIDS, you know, and the artist and the AIDS. And we shot it, this on 3 weeks with C302, with CNA, small crew. The prep is like the same on the first feature. We go on the city where we shoot. We stay 3 weeks to prep, to do some tests. We discuss, we scouting. And after that, let's go.
You were telling me in our conversation before that there was a lot of problems that happened on the set that you had to contend with. Tell us everything that sort of happened on that production.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, it's a small budget, so you can do what you want. So we have a lot of problems, like Snowzilla. Mm-hmm. It's the snow. I remember it was a Monday night, I think. We goes to studio, and when we goes out the studio, we have 70 centimeters of snow. What? And we lived in Brooklyn. The studio is in Jersey, so it's so far.
Yeah.
And the first day of shoot, the one actor didn't want to come. We don't know why. Yeah. And when 2 days after, I broke my glasses. So 3 days, I have just one glass, and this is out. It's crazy. Wow. The main actress broken ankle.
Mm-hmm.
So she can't walk for 2 or 3 days. So wow, what we did? Oh, okay. We do another shot and like this. And New York, it's very different than 80s, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was the difficult part, because the car are not the same. The first floor of the building are not the same. Now it's nails, you know, with neon and like that. It was very, very stressful.
And,
you know?
And I think that that's a lesson for a lot of independent filmmakers, is there's for first time filmmakers or newer filmmakers, they want to do what we call period pieces. They want to do a movie that takes place in a different time, in an older time. And the lesson I always heard is that doing period pieces are very expensive, you know, because it's all the little details that matter, like the cars and the storefronts and the wardrobes and everything. And I was always told that the minute you do a period piece and you don't have the money for it, it looks bad and nobody will want to watch your film. Even if it's a really good story, it just is not very authentic. And how were you able to work around having a small budget and still create such a great looking film?
Yeah. So the first thing, it's a good prep. Like this, if you are really, really a good prep, you can switch, or you can thinking another way of do a plan. Depend. But after that, be smart. You need to be smart and to a bit of instinct,
mm-hmm.
you know,
Is there a sense of framing as well that you can't do wider shots, you know, like you can't do extreme wide shots, you can't do wide shots. How do you get around, you know, telling your story without those types of framings?
The shot were more difficult. It's the wide shot because we see everything, you know. So you can thinking about if I put something on the first plan, I can avoid the car, not the good one, or more on the left, more on your right. And sometimes you find the good things like this. It's like an exercise, or you try to avoid what you don't want on the frame.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's difficult, sometimes it's more easy, but you need to be really concentrate.
Yeah. And how many days was the film to shoot? How many production days were there?
Production is for the shoot.
Or yeah, for the whole film. Yeah. So how?
Six weeks.
6 weeks.
6 weeks. Yeah. 3 weeks of prep, 3 weeks of shooting.
Wow. Yeah.
And we, I gave you a small tips on the movie. We shot. We rent a big studio. It's like a loft, and we did seven set on wow. this place. So we stay one half week on this place, but we shot the hospital, the gay club, the box of the nightclub, the studio photos, the gallery. We shot a lot of things on the same place. So we save money like this, yeah. You know.
That's brilliant. That is absolutely brilliant. And who's that was Cyril's idea, or was that the producer's idea? Where did that idea come from to do that? Oh,
it's a Cyril, the producer. When we were scouting, he told me. It's the place, you know. We can do this. We can do this. If we put a wall, we can separate two place, and we create we create everything. And Matthew, the the art department, it's really cool too. And he made a really good place for that.
And how was it having to light the same environment, but to create, you know, very different moods and very different looks for each sort of scene or each environment? How was that experience? Was it difficult? Was it easy because you're all in one place and you got to know the location? What was that experience like having to light?
It's the beginning. It's difficult because you at each time you shoot something, you say no, it's like the another place, no, the world, and at the moment you avoid that. I just did what I do usually. I make light, you know, and let's do this. And we put an HMI outside, and we.
And what was the lighting package like for this film? Do you
light? It's 2.5, you know, HMI. So it's really tight.
Yeah, yeah.
We have a Kinos, LEDs too.
Did you have to run if you had a 2.5K, presumably you had to run a generator. So how often were you running, you know, Kinoflows and LEDs off of, say, house power versus having to bring in the generator? Were you using the generator a lot? Did you have a lot of big lights often?
No. We used the generator one time, not more. And I tried to use the practical light where when it's possible, mm-hmm. because you can play with this on the frame, and it's like natural. You change just the bulb. And it's enough.
Are you, in the work that you do today, are you using LED lights more and more? Or do you still stay with some of the traditional lights like the Kinoflows or the HMIs and the tungstens? What are you doing today more?
I use more the HMI and LEDs because I love work with daylight, you know, but it depends. Each project need a special camera or special light. You know, I can't tell you I use that. I try to use the best tools what I can for the project, you know. And with the LEDs, the traditional light are less expensive now, so sometimes I rent the traditional, and sometimes I use the LEDs. It depends what we're doing.
And do you feel as a cinematographer, you came up through the camera department as a, you know, third, second, first AC. Were you always more interested in framing and camera movement, or was there a bigger interest in lighting? Because we usually find that you'll either kind of come up through one of the strains. You'll either come up through the camera department or come up as a electrician to a gaffer and then become a director of photography. Do you have a preference? Do you prefer to work with the camera and allow your gaffer to do the lighting? Or are you more hands-on with the lighting? Is that more of an interest for you? How do you approach each project?
It depends. I want to keep the frame, and I give the light with my gaffer, because when you frame, you can you know where is the flag or something, you need to be avoid on the frame, so and it's more easier. So when you can't frame, or it's I don't know, it's an operator reframe, it's less easier for him to do what you want and what the director want, I think. And friends, in general, the DP frame, a frame or another camera, it depends. But my approach from the light, it depends to my gaffer too, because sometimes I can't work with the guy who want. So each project is different. So at this moment I can tell you I work like this. It depends really, and it's like the life now.
Yeah.
Everything changes more faster.
Yeah. And when you went to both Los Angeles and to New York City, I would imagine that you were working with local crews. So the crew that you had on both films were American crews. Is that true? or
in LA, my gaffer it's a Japanese guy,
mm-hmm.
and my AC it's a Romanian guy,
yeah.
an Iranian.
Yeah.
So I manage the team more like European team, you know.
Yeah.
In New York, it's not the same. In New York, it's American guys, and it's more like American. So one time I tried to move a stand, you know, because in French, if you want a board or something, you tell I want a board no, and I can put the board, you know.
Yeah.
And in USA, I think no, you can't do that. Okay,
yeah.
I stay on my dollies. The board come, yeah. The stand come.
So, and that's interesting to hear. That it seems in France, it's much more of a hands-on approach. What were some of the other differences that you noticed between how you work on projects in France versus your experience in the United States?
The main difference for me is the number of people who are on set. You know, in America, I have every job: second, first, gaffer, best boy, electrician. Wow, it's really cool. And in France, if you have for my part, I think if you have on the small production, you can't add a second. So you have just a first AC and gaffer. But it's more I don't know. It's more instinctive, I think, in European. You can we less rules than USA, you know.
Yeah.
And I can ask to my AC to put the stand here and put the light, you know.
Mm-hmm.
In US, sometimes it's not really that.
I wonder, would you say that the fact that there's less rules, is that more because filmmaking has changed in that it's more modern, and in a modern sense, it's more what we say democratized, which means that anybody can buy a camera and start filming and start making their own films. And so the nature of how you make a film now is less structured than it used to be, you know, 10 years ago when you had to shoot on 35mm. Would you say that that is more the case, or is it specifically in France where it's a culture of, you know, I think of like Godard and Truffaut and breaking the rules and saying, we're not going to do what everybody else does, we're going to do it our own way. Is it more of a culture that creates that environment, or is it something that has only happened in the last decade or so?
Yeah, I think it's both, you know, and we need rules on the set, for sure, you know. But too much rules, it's slow. The
yeah.
set go more slowly, you know.
Yeah.
And sometimes we need to run. And
yeah.
If you are a small team, or if you don't put the mat box or some things, it's
yeah.
not important. We need to shoot that, and
yeah.
you at the end of the day, you need to have all your shot, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So,
one of the things that really interests me is that when hearing about going back to the Goyard piece, is that you shot that in 2 days
yeah.
on a camera that is not known to have exceptional latitude. It's not an Alexa, it's not a red camera. I always have this, you know, sort of romantic notion that when I get on set that I bring out my light meter and that I light the set and I have discussions and I put this light here. But then in a case like you shot Goyard, which is you know, very little prep, very little time to shoot, go, that suddenly all my plans about how I was going to light this kind of go out the window, and I'm rushing now. I'm like, oh, okay, we got to get this shot. We have to go fast, 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 fast. How do you maintain quality in an environment that goes very, very fast? How do you ensure that you get the right exposure, that you don't overshoot unnecessary footage? How do you keep the quality high when the pace is also high?
It's an interesting question because I never thinking about that, you know. So when we shoot in Goyard, so we put the camera, okay, we do this frame, okay, we frame. The first thing it's frame, and when we frame, now light, okay, she did that, okay, so okay, put the light here, take, okay, and. At each time we discussed with the director, and it's like that you can do the best things, you know.
And with a project like that, was it storyboarded specifically? Were there specific shots that the director knew you needed?
Yes, some shot was storyboarded, but a lot of shot are imagine on the place, you know.
Wow.
You have the storyboards for one minute, I think. So we need to do this, but we shot a lot. We have a lot of stuff for make the best story you can we can.
Were there any instances in your career where you made some big mistakes and you had to learn from them? Anything that stands out as though, you felt like I will never do that again. I you did something wrong.
Yeah, don't forget the recall.
That happens to a lot more people than people let up,
It's in France you say a double rec. It's like the operator put the rec and the AC put rec too, and so no rec.
That's
No,
certainly
like rec.
burnt me.
And don't forget the sandbag to the stand. You learn like that. So you learn when you did a mistake, you learn. The important things it's not did the same mistake.
And you come from a culture, or at least your experience is based on mentorship, it seems to be, where, like we talked about at the start of the interview, you spend time learning from other DOPs, you spend time as an assistant camera. So, looking back, do you see how the quality of your work has evolved, or did it evolve slowly, or was there a time or an instance that you saw a big change occur in the quality of your work?
From my point of view, it's slowly, but when I speaking with the other friend or people, he asked, he told me, you work, you grew up a lot, and I remember when you shoot it 3 or 4 years ago, you are not the same guys. I think I grew up, but this the job we learn everything at the end of at the end of shooting you learn, and for it I think all my life is like that. I learn when I was on set. I learn a lot. I learned when I saw other people work. I learn when I go to the museum. I try to learn and try to apply when I have on my mind at one time. I try to work like that, and I think I grew up, but slowly.
I kind of want to close out the interview by asking sort of two questions. One is, For those who are beginning their career in cinema, for those especially beginning their career in the camera department or as an electrician, and they have aspirations to become a cinematographer, based on your experience now and in everything that you've done to this point, is there any particular or specific advice that, you want to offer them?
I will tell them try again, and don't be afraid about trying something. It's not because the windows is here and the light come to here. The light came here. If you can justify what you're doing, you have no problem, and don't be afraid about project. And sometimes you can be afraid, but you do do what you do.
So basically, to take chances and to continue to do work. I think that that's definitely a fear by some people, is they fear doing bad work. But the progression to doing good work requires you to do a certain amount of bad work, you know, to work out and to experiment and to try. It's almost like you rule out all the bad stuff, you know. It's like, yeah, I've done all the bad things, so now I don't do those bad things anymore. I only do, you know, the good things. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's a lot way. Yeah. What I want to say, but
exactly. And you also told me in our email conversation that you run 3 times a week, that you're active physically. You know, I'm very active too, and I know that in this business, especially when you're doing a lot of heavy cameras and you're moving quickly, that having a certain level of physical fitness is really important, just for the physicality of the job. But also, obviously, it keeps you with a healthy mind and it gives you energy. How important has that been for you to be physically active?
It's important because when I run, I try to concentrate on my body, on my or sometimes I am thinking about a project, you know, and I can imagine what I doing when I was on set. I thinking at everything. Mm-hmm. And the sport, it's important for breath and I don't know how I can explain that. It's a good feeling, you know. Mm-hmm. when you finish the sport, you are really distressed. and you can starting to with the fresh idea. Mm. And you can start a good reflection. Mm.
One of the challenges that I've certainly faced in trying to remain physically active is that filmmaking requires not just a lot of physical energy, but a lot of mental and psychological energy. And by the end of a shoot day, or if you're shooting a lot, you're both fatigued mentally and physically, and it's hard to maintain the motivation to put on your running shoes at the end of a day. Or, you know, we're used to call times that are 6 in the morning, so to get up at 5 to go for a half an hour run, how do you maintain the energy and the discipline to continue to be active when you're working as in the film industry?
For me, it's not the same energy. It's energy where I work, and energy when I evacuate, you know. Mm. Or when I it's more like a game. Mm. You know, like it's not the same energy we use, not the same. But sometimes I told me, I don't want to run.
Yeah.
But I give me a foot on my ass and I put my my basket and I goes to run. And after 5 minutes, I forget the bad idea.
And do you typically run on the days that you're not working, or do you run in the mornings? Do you run when you get back from set? What's your schedule?
It depends. The best day for me it's when I'm free. But at the end of the set, sometimes I put my basket and I go to run, and I want to run. And sometimes the morning, it depends really. It depends really how I manage my schedule.
And what's next for you in your career? What type of projects are you working on? What's coming up for you, and where do you want to see your career headed?
I hope I doing another feature last year, maybe. I cross the finger. No, for the moment I'm concentrate on the short movie. I shot with Epic W, and I'm concentrated like on this project for the moment. So I have some commercial or some shooting music video, but
And what's your experience in working with the red cameras? Do you enjoy it? Do you find it difficult? What's your experience like?
It's like a cube. So when I am a AC, I hate this camera, you know, because then she need accessories or cheese plate or a lot of things. But for exterior days, I like the sensor for that, because the dynamic it's very impressive. And for the night, I shot with a 320 ISO. I changed the ISO for the, because the noise it's on the low light, it's not the the best cameras, the red cameras. The Arri cameras or Alexa, it's better on the low light and skin tone.
Mm-hmm.
But the red with the 8K, it's amazing, mm-hmm. You know?
Incredible. Well, thank you so much for spending an hour with us. I really appreciate it. There's some great things that I learned about how you approach your productions, and I really value your time today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you too.